Hello everybody, my name is RetroBoy03 and welcome to my review of LEGO Marvel Super Heroes Spider-Man Homecoming, set number 76083, Beware the Vulture. This set comes with 375 pieces, 4 minifigures, and retails for around $40 in the United States. So without further ado, let's take a look at the minifigures. Starting us off here, we have the MCU version of Spider-Man, as he appeared in Captain America Civil War and Spider-Man Homecoming, and this figure is pretty great. In fact, I would say it's probably the best figure LEGO's made for the MCU. And in fact, since the Civil War sets, LEGO has slightly updated this figure in a few ways to make it a bit more accurate to how it appeared in the MCU. To start with, we'll start on the face, which looks pretty good. The webbing is basically just fine lines, but it's nice. And around the lenses, you have some nice silver detailing, so that's all well and good. His torso is pretty good. Again, the webbing design continues. You have the MCU Spider-Man logo, which looks pretty good. Not to mention, just the sides of his torso have some pretty nice detailing. Just zooming in here. I mean, maybe it'll focus a bit. You can see some black detailing in there, in the blue areas, which is nice to see. You can also sort of see that continuing down onto the legs, which are dual molded, and you can also see a bit of black printing going down onto the red boots. You can see here that Spidey's arm printing is pretty nice. You have the webbing continuing onto the dark blue arm to sort of create the multi-layered effect. And you have some black areas to represent his web canisters, and then just some other straps as well. And it's the same print on the other side, just inverse. And then up here, you can see on the back of the head, it's pretty simple detailing for the continuation of the web. We see pretty much the same detailing on practically every Spider-Man minifigure, just to have the webbing on the back of the head. So it's simple, but it's still very important to see. And then on the back of the torso, you have the Spidey logo in the blue area, as well as just some more webbing and some more black detailing. So that's this Spidey, but something else you get with this guy is, of course, accessories. And this version of Spidey comes with quite a few accessories, that is, of course. To start with, you get two of these Power Blast pieces in white to represent Spidey's shooting web, and again, you do get two plus an extra, so in actuality, you get three. And basically, if you don't know how these work, you just put them in a minifigure's hand, aim them at your target, push on the back of the handle, and they'll just fly off as a projectile. They don't work great, but I don't mind them for two reasons. Number one, they, unlike super jumpers, they don't damage your figures. And number two, I mean, they look good. Like, you could easily just use these as just an accessory to look nice in, like, an action scene. So, yeah, super jumpers. Power blasts are pretty cool. But that's not the only accessory we get with Spidey, because he also gets a printed 1x2 tile for a cell phone. And this isn't a new print. It's been appearing, I believe, since the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles sets, specifically, I think, one of the 2014 ones. And it's been used quite a bit since, but it has some nice detailing. Like, you get the power bar, you get it's at 81% battery, and you get, and I guess this is maybe supposed to be a sort of, it obviously, like, it's in a call, but then you also have the keypad, so I'm a bit confused about how this works and what phone this is actually supposed to be. I guess it's just sort of a Lego brand smartphone, but this is a nice piece to get. I mean, I think it would have been cool to maybe do a print to represent, like, maybe Peter talking to Ned, But it's fine. Just as an extra piece. But Spidey also gets something that we've been seeing since the very first Spider-Man sets back in 2002 for the Studios line. He gets a white rope to represent a piece of web for him to swing on. And this is pretty cool because, of course, there are two uses for this. One is that you could attach the bar or one of the clips onto any sort of building and then just have Spidey swing across. Or, of course, you could attach Spidey onto one of the bars to have him climbing up the web. Either way works pretty great, and I'm glad that LEGO still uses this piece in Spider-Man sets to this day. It's a very useful thing to get. But zooming back in, the last thing we get with Spidey here is just this, this big spider web piece, which isn't exactly, I mean, like, you can't exactly have him hold this, but there is a feature with this piece that comes in later, and it's cool to just get another web option. Like, you get a ton of web stuff with Spidey here, which is obviously cool for setting up scenes. However, something that seems noticeably missing is if you remember back in 2016 with the Spider-Man bridge battle, the Doc Ock tentacle trap, the Ghost Rider set, and the Civil War tanker truck, Spidey had a piece that looked like he was at, like, it was in the process of shooting a web from his hand, and I think it's kind of odd that piece is just missing here. Like, I don't have one on hand, but, like, if you look at the box art for the tanker truck showdown, you'll see what I'm talking about. The piece that looks like a web being shot. I don't know why LEGO got rid of that piece. I mean, I guess because it doesn't really do anything to add to play value, and it just would have been another web accessory for Spidey, and he already has quite enough, but it would have been cool to see, but I can't really complain since this guy already comes with 5 accessories, and I mean, like, the figure's so great, he really didn't, like, if this wasn't Spider-Man, it would have been fine if he had come with none, and, like, really, since this is Spider-Man, I would have been fine if he'd literally just had this rope, I would have been fine, but we get so many accessories with this figure, and it's such a great figure that I can't really complain. So, that was Spider-Man, and now let's move on to the next figure in this set. Next up here we have Iron Man, and before I give you a full look at the figure, you can see that his accessories, he just gets his standard repulsor pieces we've been seeing since the Avengers sets back in 2012. He gets 2 trans blue cylinders for exhaust coming out of his feet. Then he also just has 2 blue studs underneath of his hands, and that just sort of creates the look that he's flying with his repulsors. But taking those off, we can get a closer-up look at this figure, which, in my opinion, is pretty great. Starting off with the helmet, this is not a new design for the helmet. In fact, we've been seeing this print since 2015 with the Mark 43 in the Age of Ultron sets. And we're still seeing it with the updated Mark 43 in the UCS Hulkbuster set. But this is a nice print. You can see that, you have some black lining, a bit of outlining around the eyes, and, like, you'll be able to see it a bit better when I open up the mask, but there's even a little bit of red printing on the cheeks to make the actual golden face mask seem a bit slimmer. Around the back, this is, of course, just the same mold that we've been seeing on LEGO Iron Man figures ever since the Avengers. Nothing new here, same with the face mask, same molds, but if I lift this up, we have something that will be a bit confusing to you if you haven't seen Spider-Man Homecoming yet, so minor spoilers ahead. I'll give you 5 seconds to turn off this video or just skip ahead a few minutes, I guess. But anyway, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Underneath the helmet, we have a blank trans blue head, because in the movie, during this scene that this is based off of, the Iron Man suit was just being controlled by, I believe, Friday it would have been? Or, well, no, actually, it's been a while since I've seen the movie. No, I believe it was actually Tony remote controlling the suit himself, if I can even talk today, but yeah. That's just a trans blue head with no printing, but moving down, you can see that the torso and legs are very nice on this guy. The torso is an edited version of the Mark 40, sick suit from Captain America Civil War, and the legs are completely new, though. However, that's less because this is new leg design, more because the legs should also just be basically a silvery version of the design from Civil War, but for Civil War, like, it didn't make new legs. They just reused the Mark 43 legs for some reason, but yeah, the legs here are pretty great, as is the torso. You get a lot of nice detail, metallic silver all over, as well as a few gold highlights. You have the many different, I don't know if those are actual, like, mini arc reactors. I don't believe they are. I think those are just little lights, but then there's the one main arc reactor. But anyway, those all look very nice. From the back, the great detail continues with all the thin lining, the silver and gold metallic designs, just some gray mixed in with the silver to create some contrast. And as you can see, he actually does have a silver belt piece. But yeah, to be honest, that's really all there is to this new Iron Man Mark 46 minifigure. So now let's move on to the Vulture. The next figure we get in this set is the Vulture, who is, of course, the main antagonist of Spider-Man Homecoming. And I feel as though LEGO did a pretty alright job with this figure, though it could have been better. Starting off with his helmet, you can see that LEGO did not make a new mold here. Instead, they opted to just remold the comic book Invincible Iron Man helmet piece in dark green and create this nice new print for the front. And while you could say that that's a bit lazy, and honestly, I would probably have to agree with you, I do feel as though the print on the front at least is really nice, with the black face mask, with the glowing green eyes, and then of course, like, the breather around the mouth. And underneath of the mask, if you're curious, this isn't a spoiler, but that's the face of the Vulture. It's the same face print that LEGO used for the comic book Vulture in the Doc Ock mech set from 2016. Around the back, you just have some printed on liver spots. But yeah, I feel as though this face does actually work pretty well for Michael Keaton, to be honest. Like, I mean, maybe the liver spots? I mean, like, I'm not sure about those. And also, like, the eyebrows shouldn't be white, but I feel as though, like, aside from that, this face does actually work pretty well. There's no printing on the legs, which are just in dark green, but the torso has some nice detailing to it. I'll just put the helmet back on for the time being. I mean, like, the torso printing isn't too detailed, but it does a good job of capturing his jacket, which probably should be dark brown for the leather jacket, but I think this works fine here. Like, you have some nice belts that I'm guessing would help to fasten him to his wingsuit. Yeah. It's just some nice detailing for this torso print. Around the back, he has this clear neck brace, which is what he uses to attach to his wings. Just pulling that off, you can see the rest of his back printing, which is pretty nice. I mean, just kind of continuing the straps as well as the fur detailing at the top. And yeah, pretty much that is the Vulture, the main antagonist of Spider-Man Homecoming, and makes up approximately one-third of the parts with this set when we get to his wings, which we will in a minute. But before we do, let's take a look at the Shocker. Last and probably least of the figures included in this set, here we have the Shocker, one of the minor villains of Spider-Man Homecoming. As in, I think he only had a couple scenes, and he only, like, had one fight scene, if I'm correct. And it's kind of funny, because if you remember back when these sets were first revealed, LEGO kept this guy whited out on the box as a mystery figure, which is really ridiculous when you think about it. Because wouldn't Iron Man be more of a spoiler? Just saying, like, I think that Iron Man is more of a spoiler than the Shocker is. But, I mean, this is still a nice figure, kind of. I mean, his face printing is not new. It's one that's been appearing since Star Wars The Force Awakens sets for a lot of... it's been used for Rebel Troopers in Rogue One. It's been used for several Imperial Troopers. in The Force Awakens and The Last Jedi. It's been used for Killmonger in Black Panther, and here it is for the Shocker. Kind of lazy for Leggett to reuse this head, but honestly, the Shocker didn't do much in Homecoming, so I can kind of see it. His legs have no printing, but his torso is pretty nice. I mean, you just have this nice jacket design, which honestly you could probably just use for a standard figure. Like, there's really nothing on this torso that makes it unique to the Shocker. However, there are two things about this figure on the side here. First off, is that he has gorilla mitts from The Legends of Chima, so that's stupid. But his arm printing, this man has waffle arms, alternatively, pineapple arms. Either interpretation is valid. That's beautiful. Anyway, just to be real, that is a pretty simple print, but it's nice to see. LEGO totally could have just gone with plain yellow arms, and I wouldn't have minded at all. Did he even have yellow arms in the movie? I barely remember this guy. Anyway, the back just has the hood and the continuation of his shirt. His jacket, actually, not a shirt, anyway. So, that's the Shocker, and that's the last figure in this set. So now let's move on to the first of our two main builds, the Vulture. Well, perhaps I should have said the Vulture's wings, because that's really what we've got here for this build. Just fixing a couple things over there, but yeah, again, the Vulture does just attach on with this clear neck brace, just onto those two available studs at the top. But you do have some nice stuff going on here. Starting off with, for attack, you just have a couple of stud shooter guns just clipped onto the wings there, if I can get the Vulture to stay onto his own wings. Those are just clipped on, they can fire off. You all know how stud shooters work, so I'm not going to demonstrate them. And of course, since they're just clipped on, you can easily just pull them out if you wanted to use them with the figures. So that's pretty cool. On the back, you have a couple of stickers to get some nice detailing, as well as these two bits on the back, which these should have like turbines in them, but LEGO didn't put any fan pieces in there, so that's a bit awkward. On the bottom, you have that nice exhaust piece, and from the back, you can just have some very simple, just backs of pieces. Although I do feel as though the 2x2 round plates do help a little. Those could be like little bits of exhaust, maybe. From the front, this looks pretty great, though, of course. That was basically the only intent of this build, to look good from the front. You have these nice angled wedge pieces on the bottom. You have the Nexonite shields arranged in sort of a pretty simple but pretty nice pattern. Like, I'm pretty sure in the movie there was just circuitry there, and this almost makes it look like solar panels on the Vulture's wings, so that's pretty cool. You also have a green light on each side, and these bits off to the sides, which look a bit feathery. So that's nice. Each of those can be angled independently. They're all just on a standard bar hinge. And the wings themselves can also angle since they're just on click hinges and these pieces are on ball joints, as you probably saw. So, yeah, there's a lot of stuff you can do with these wings. You have shooters, you have lots of articulation, and, well, I mean, you also just have the ability to just fly them around. However, one complaint that I have seen time and again with this build in the set is, simply put, the Vulture's wings are absolutely massive. They are way too big to go with the figure, and well, yes and no. On one hand, yeah, they are, in terms of height, they are way off. But when you think about it, in terms of width, and like these are accurate wings scaled to the width of a person instead of the height, because obviously, with the sort of wonky scale of minifigures, it can be pretty hard for LEGO to scale things. Sometimes they go with height being minifig scale. Sometimes they go with width being minifig scale. Sometimes they just have to put things out of scale, either to fit the cost of a set, make a set not super overpriced, or just to go with scale. Because obviously, if they make something to, say, height scale, that would make, like, a doorway too thin. Obviously, they have to change that. You get what I'm saying. Minifig scale is a difficult thing. So here I feel as though LEGO scaled the wings to the Vulture's width without really giving much of a thought to the Vulture's height. So as a result, he's the accurate width compared to his wings, but he's just looks super tiny because he's so short. That was long and drawn out. Anyway, now let's take a look at what I think, what I guess is the main build of this set. Although definitely not the most interesting. I would say that these wings are probably the most interesting build of the set. But they're not the main attraction. Let's move on to the Vulture or and the Shocker's van. So here we have this white van, which, to be honest, isn't too interesting, although I do like the build here. As you can see, there are lots of different stickers here to make the build look very roughed up, and I don't know, honestly, I kind of wish maybe I'd left some of these stickers off, because I do feel as though this vehicle would actually look pretty good just driving around in your city. Like, if you built this without the stickers, you could just have this be a standard van, but anyway, you can see the grille at the front, you have some nice lights. At the front, you have the hood smashed in with a sticker, as well as a bit of webbing on the windshield. You have the rear-view mirrors, you have this rear-view mirrors, if I can speak without sounding like Tomator. You have some Speed Champions wheels here, so this can, of course, just roll with rubber tires. On the side, you have some nice curvature. Pretty simple, but it's nice. Yeah, you can see you have some hinges there for an action feature. I'm not a fan of the yellow stripe there. I mean, I'm guessing it's accurate, I think, but it just looks kind of off to me. Also, on the back, you can clearly see the gaps of these cheese slopes, and just in general, this thing looks pretty bad from the back. The ramp just sticks off as being a trapdoor piece. And you have, how's my driving? Shocking. I'm gonna burn this set now. I just stole a joke from Michael MGF, end my life. Anyway, you can see the other side, the build is the same, just with different stickers. And, like, the reason I'm not talking about the stickers is that they're really nothing to talk about, just either withering or a web. But in terms of action features, to start with, if you want to get a figure in, you can remove the roof, and it's still difficult to get a guy in there, so you also want to just pull off the windshield as well, and in general, that's something I'd always recommend doing when trying to seat a figure in a vehicle. I mean, like, unless it's a spaceship where the windshield opens up to, like, a full 90 degrees, it's just easier to just pull it off to get a figure in. Anyway, you can just seat the Vulture on these four available studs in front of this steering wheel, put him in there, and then just reattach the windshield. If you're curious, there you really can't get him to sit just on the left side. Like you can't get him to sit like over here to make it look more like he's just driving the vehicle. Like a multi-seat vehicle, like a normal van, he does have to sit in the middle, which is a bit sad. I'm not a fan of when that happens, but it's a thing. You can't really avoid it at this scale. I mean, they could have, but it would have been difficult, so I can see why they just went with this route. And another feature is that if you want to show a bit of withering, like, during the battle, you could have Spidey come in, like, maybe with his web, or maybe this could just happen, like, from the van hitting something or something, but you could just take the ramp, pull it down, and the web just broke off. Anyway, you can pull off the ramp, and the thing is, the feature is that then you can attach your white web piece to the back of it and then do this. So, I mean, like, you could then have Spidey just, like, standing on the web, or the web could be used to, like, slow the vehicle down. Or you could attach Spidey's rope web onto this and he could just be dragged around. There are several things you could do with that. I mean, heck, you could even just use the web as a ramp now. That honestly fits a bit better just folded up than this does, to be completely honest. That's kind of sad. But yeah, I'm just going to replace the normal ramp, because while the web is interesting, I honestly do feel as though the normal ramp doesn't just make more sense, even if it does look really awkward. But anyway, the main feature of this van is you can just fold open this side, fold open this side, fold down the ramp, or just tear it off and replace it with a web. And you have some interior. Starting off in here, you can probably see it already, but you can just pull this up. You have a six-stud shooter. Just turn the gear and it'll fire off studs. You know, I'm just gonna show you, I guess. Give me a second to recover those studs. Well, anyway, there are a couple of other features on the inside of the model. Starting off, you can see that on each side there is a little bit clipped on to the sides, and basically what you can do is you can pull both of these off, and you can connect these two assemblies together to create a gun. Okay, what's kind of interesting is that this same gun build was used in the Spider-Man Bridge battle set from 2016 for Kraven the Hunter, but anyway, yeah, I mean, just pretty simple. Take a lightsaber hilt, stud, T-bar, and Exo-Force droid arm, boom, gun. Apparently, I mean, I don't think it looks that good, but it's a thing you can do. In here, you can see the rest of the space is not, like, none of the space in here is designed for minifigures, which is kind of unfortunate. And I kind of wish they'd built in maybe a bit of a lab here, like, maybe even make the vehicle a bit bigger, maybe even, like, this is accurately sized, but heck, maybe Lego could have made the vehicle a bit oversized. Like, I wouldn't have minded if maybe we could have gotten a bit of the lab back here, but it's fine. All we've really got left in here is just a couple of boxes. This, you get a sticker on the top of each. This one is basically, the instructions tell you to leave it blank. I just think it's a good place to store some extra studs for your stud shooters. This box, though, is a bit more interesting because in here we have this build, which is supposed to be a piece of Chitauri tech. Basically, it's a bomb. I'm not going to tell you how or if it plays into the movie's plot, but that is supposed to be a bomb according to the description of the set, I believe. And just a little tip, if you don't want the boxes to constantly sloshing around, put one of them on its side. Because there's basically just the perfect amount of space for it to fit in between the side and the groove of here. So if you lay a box on its side, that'll just completely lock them both in. Just a little tip. And also, if you don't have someone in the driver's seat, then the boxes can just fly forward into the seat since there's nothing barricading them. Anyway, one last thing is you have this sticker on here, the little bar that sort of works as the lift arm for the gun. You have a sticker for the Department of Damage Control. Since, of course, the Vulture did originally work for the Department of Damage Control before stealing some Chitauri tech from the Battle for New York from the Avengers. Oh, here's a stud. Is that missing? No, that's good. Weird. Anyway, that is pretty much, well, that is not pretty much, that is everything that's included with this set, the 76083 Beware the Vulture set. So, overall, for $40, would I recommend this set? I mean, I would say so. I mean, I have it, so I would probably recommend you get it. Like, I guess that's sort of the problem with my channel, thinking about it, seeing as how I don't really have the funds to get every LEGO set ever. I pretty much only give positive reviews because I don't get sets that I don't feel positively about, because, well, I mean, really, why would I? Why would I review sets that I don't like? Why would I buy sets that I don't like? I'm just setting this up for, I guess, a pose, maybe. Does this work? Yeah, I guess that works. Wait. But yeah, I'm just posing this up. I don't know, maybe I'll use it for the thumbnail, maybe not, depending on how it turns out. But anyway, so yeah, I would recommend this set for $40. Well, Spidey's a great minifig, Iron Man's a pretty good minifig, Vulture's a pretty good minifig. Shocker's an ant minifig, but he has waffle arms, which makes him the best minifig in the set by default. The Vulture wings are a cool build. The van is a nice build. Overall, this is a nice set. And I would recommend it for $40. So thank you all so much for watching this review, and I will see all of you in the next review very soon. Bye-bye.